A very good evening to all of you. And this art of Avadhanam is a very unique, indigenous, classical Indian art. Avadhanam, the word, literally means concentration. Ava and Dhanam. Ava is the prefix and Dhanam is the main word. It has come from dha, dharane, to bear, to sustain. Indian culture emphasizes more on sustenance than any other thing. And in that sense, Avadhanam is also an art of well placing the things, well focusing the things, well concentrating the things. To become an art, it needs imagination. Without imagination, there is no art. In that sense, we have some creativity. Avadhanam is known for its spontaneity and extempore creativity. The word Avadhanam, it occurs in many shastras as well. And many of our learning, many of our sciences and arts, they owe their origin in the Vedas. And the Vedas were recited in various forms. There are 8 forms of reciting the Vedas. The Pada, Krama, Jata, Ghana, Ratha, Danda, Dvaja, Mala. Like that we have very many ways of chanting the Veda. And to preserve the text properly with all the connotations. And there it needed a lot of concentration. And that's why people who used to recite the Vedas properly without missing even a syllable, even a phoneme, they were called as the Vedavadhanis. But it is part of our tradition and religion. But to become an art, as I mentioned earlier, we need imagination and some sort of creativity. And then developed Avadhanam as an art. We all know the very well-known work, Kama Sutra of Bhagavan Vatsyayana. Vatsyayana's name is always associated with the Kama Sutra, supposed to be containing a lot of things about erotics, but it's not that itself. It's one among the 4 Purusharthas. It is the value system of the universe. In that sense, Kama is all sort of judicious enjoyment. Dharma viruddho bhuteshu, kamosmi bharatarshabha, so says the Bhagavad Gita. And in Kama Sutra, we have all the 64 arts. This is how we can imagine how profoundly our tradition looked at the aspect of kama or enjoyment. Among the 64 arts, many of the arts are connected with the present art, what I'm going to discuss about that to you, and that is Avadhanam. Avadhanam is two-folded. One is the aspect of completing the tasks, and other is the aspect of retention, purana, completion of the tasks, and retention, following them, keeping in track and then executing them, handling all the issues intact without any confusion or without any loss of memory, rather without any loss of transmission, that becomes dharana. And then the third aspect is also there. While meeting the tasks, while having the retention, we should also engage and entertain the audience. If not, it will become a feat and it will no more be elevated to the level of an art. That's why we have something like the Trinity, as we call Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwara. Creativity, that is completion of the tasks. Purana is associated with the creator, Brahma. And then sustenance, retention, a memory connected with the Lord of sustenance, maintenance, Vishnu. And then entertainer, the great entertainer, Mahanata, Mahadeva or Shiva, Sabharanjanam, as we call. So all these 3 aspects put together is this art of Avadhanam. A person who can perform this art is called Avadhani. He has to have so many things in his bag. Though he is not given any writing material, though not any such prepared syllabus or any such thing is given, he has to be ready to answer any question. And the answers should come out in the form of either prose or poem. As per the demand, some of the aspects of Avadhanam will be always in the versified form and some other will be in the prose form. And something will be light and some other thing will be serious. But both these things should be delightful. That we should never miss. This art of Avadhanam has many sub-branches in itself. Though I am practicing the art of Avadhanam in poetry, there are many other forms of Avadhanas as well. The Gita Avadhana, connected with music, or the Sangeeta Avadhanam, and then the Nritya Avadhana, or Natya Avadhana, connected with dance, and Chitra Avadhana, which I myself have devised, and my esteemed friend and great artist, Dr. B.K.S. Verma, is an exponent of that. And then we have something like the Ganita Avadhana, connected with mathematics, and Netra Avadhana, connect with something like by moving the eyes, eyebrows and eyeballs in various ways, a sentence will be communicated. It's something like the dumb chariots, Netra Avadhanam, and Ghanta Avadhanam, Kalasha Avadhanam, Trina Avadhanam, like that, so many other forms. I'm not going to those details. But the most important and most celebrated and most enjoyable is, of course, the Sahitya Avadhanam, because it has both the forms of Purana and Dharana, creation and retention, coupled with entertainment and education as well. Education without tears and entertainment of a higher order. Here, the Avadhani should be an extempore poet who can come out with verses without using paper or pen. Spontaneity is very, very important, and it will be going on simultaneously. There are many forms of Sahitya Avadhanams, depending upon the number of questions. People who pose questions should also be scholars. They should be well-versed in the nuances of the art, and they should be knowing the classical nature of the language. All these things are prerequisites of them. They are called prachakas. Prachakas means prachanti iti prachakah. They question. If the Avadhani is unable to answer, they should be good enough to answer. Yes, here is the answer. Always, a responsible question should be posed. That's the intention. And in the Avadhanams, two main forms are seen, Ashtavadhanam and Shatavadhanam, and we have Sahasravadhanam as well. And in between, we have many other Avadhanams, Dvadashavadhanam, Dashavadhanam, like that. But Ashtavadhanam and Shatavadhanam are most popular, and even since time immemorial, they are very popular. In India, in several languages, we do see that. The oldest recorded evidence of these forms of Avadhanam and the description of the Avadhanams can be seen in Kannada, Telugu, Tamil, and then of course Sanskrit, Prakrit, they're always present. So Sanskrit nurtured in all these languages how the art of Avadhanam should be evolved. Now coming to the most basic form of Avadhanam, that is the Ashtavadhanam. It's something like the 2020 cricket match. And Shatavadhanam can be compared to something like the one-day international or the test match or even the Sahasravadhanam. Though the number of questions multiply, the basic format remains more or the same. Here, the questioning scholars will sit around the Avadhani and they'll be having writing material, and they will start writing the answers as and when the Avadhani gives the answers in the versified form or sometimes in the prose form as well. In Ashtavadhanam, 8 people will be involved apart from the Avadhani. 8 people, 8 questioning people, scholars called Prachakas. One item is called Nishedhakshara, the other one is Samasyapurna, the third one is Dattapadi, and the fourth one, I prefer Chitra Kavita, the most difficult, which I have introduced myself for the first time. And if not, some people will be using Nyastakshari, something like that. And then the Ashoka Vitva, and then the Kavya Vachana, and then Aprastuta Prasanga, and finally some counting scheme, which is Ganta Vadana, or sometimes it is Pushpa Ganana, counting the number of flowers which have been thrown on the Avadhani, or else magic squares, Sankhya Bandha, some other mathematical issues, something like that. I shall explain these elements one by one in a brief way. Nishedhakshara means a topic will be given. On that topic, Avadhani should come out with a verse in such a way that every word, every letter, every syllable of that will be checked. For example, the Avadhani is demanded to compose a poem on Ganesh, the Lord Ganapati. We all know the elephant faced god. The questioning scholar says the first letter should not be Va, Vinayaka, something you may use. Then Avadhani taking my name, Ganesha, something, Ga, he says. I think you'll be using the next letter, Na. So Na should not be used. Na will be checked. He'll be saying, he's an elephant-faced god, of course. That's why Ja is the most preferred one, Gaja. I know you'll be saying Ma, Gaja Mukha, something like that, elephant-faced. So Ma is the next letter which will be prohibited. Then he'll be using other letter card, Va, Gaja Vadana, something. They have so many synonyms in Sanskrit. Then you'll be noticing Avadhani is a scholar, so also is the Prachaka. He knows the nuances of the language and immediately says, Da should not be used. Then Avadhani will be ending up in trouble if he is unable to answer this. If he knows the language well, if he knows the synonyms well, one of the synonyms of face is Kthara Vaktra. Vaktana means face. Gajavaktra means elephant-faced. Gajavaktra. Like that, this is one word. So many words should constitute a line, and four lines should constitute a poem. That's how it goes on. This is Nishedhakshara. And in Samasya, we have a cryptic line being given that may be meaningless, or sometimes it will be vulgar in nature. Sometimes it will be redundant. All these things will be posed as a challenge. Samasya is a problem in simple way. But it is a problem given in a versified manner. One line of a verse is given, and the answer should be given, the solution should be given in the rest of the three lines. For example, one samasya, which was long ago given to a great Avadhani of Andhra Pradesh, Kavyakanta Vasishta Ganapati Muni, when he had gone to Bengal, Vatsare Tvekada Gauri Pativaktram Napashyati. Once in a year, Parvati will not look at her husband's face. Shiva will not be seen by Parvati on one day in a year. How, why, we don't know. No Puranas say this. Nowhere we have the evidence or nowhere we have the answer for that matter. Immediately the Avadhani said, Chaturthyam Bhadra Shuklasya Chandra Darshana Shankaya. On the fourth day of Bhadrapada month, that is on the Ganapati festival, Parvati will not be looking at Shiva. Because of the simple reason, Shiva is Chandrasekhara, having a crescent moon on his head, on his forehead. And we all know, Ganapati had cursed moon. On that day, moon should not be seen. If somebody looks at moon, he'll be ending up in difficulties. Apavada. He'll be having some difficulty, some calamity. His name will be misused, or he'll be abused, or he'll be misunderstood. And for that fear, Parvati will never dare to look at the face of Shiva, because he is Chandrasekhara. That's how a poetic solution has been given. And then in Dattapadi, next third item, four words will be given, and also a theme will be given. Using the words, a poem has to be composed. Sometimes the words will gel with the theme, and sometimes they will not. There we have the difficulty. Once, in one of my avadhanam, in one of my shatavadhanam, first shatavadhan of mine, hello, hi, honey, sweet. These were the English words given. Using them, how Shurpanaka was addressed by Rama. Shurpanaka, the demoness. How voluptuous she was, we all know. And when she encountered Rama, how Rama would have answered her question. How Rama would have reacted to her proposal. This is how you have to describe. Vinodartham sartham muni nivaha lolo raghuvaraha. First line. Muni niva halo lo raghuvaraha. Rama is enjoyed and appreciated and admired by the seers. Muni niva halola. He has best of the company of the seers. Their muni niva halola, their halo, the word has been introduced. It's stitched in. Sprahayam ragandham vikatavanitam dandakavane. Sprahayam, she came with lust. There we have hai, sprahayam. Dandakavane, when he was in Dandaka forest, she came. Mahatejasvi pratyaya samuchitaschaikavanitaha. Mahatejasvi, Rama was brilliant. Eat pratyaya samuchitaha. He had his lordship intact. Tejasvi, there the word sweet has been stitched into the poem. Vishalakshityevam vadati mahaniyo raghuvaraha. Rama was noble. Mahaniya, there we have the word honey. So these four words, hello, hi, honey, sweet, they have been used into a Sanskrit verse. And that's how the task has been met with. In that way, Chitra Kavita. In Chitra Kavita, some peculiar structures have to be embedded within the poem, or some restricted way of using the syllables, or some double meaning, triple meaning, something like the double andre, what we call dipanning. All these things have to be introduced. Once in my Avadhanam, how difficult it would be in this modern age of Kali to pursue fine arts like Avadhanam, classical arts. No more takers, not much of glamour. How do you feel? What is the state of affairs of your art? Using only two sounds, Ka and La. Kali means the age of Kali. There is the Iron Age, as we call. How the arts will be pursued and what will be the difficulty of the artists who pursue that? That has to be the import of the poem. Kalikale kala leela kala keela la keelika kalka kaka kuki laika kaka leeko kila kula. The whole verse has only two letters, ka and la. Kalikale kala leela kala keela la keelika kalka kaka kuki laika kaka leeko kila kula. In this difficult age of so-called modernism, pursuing classical arts is something like swimming in poisonous water. Like a cuckoo, how difficult it will be for a cuckoo to move in a group of crows or vultures. So difficult it is to move with fine arts and finer tastes. That's how the import of the word verse goes. And then Ashokavitva. In Ashokavitva, when a topic is given, then and there, complete poem has to be recited. Without batting the lips, without batting the eyelashes, immediately one has to recite, as though it has been by-hearted sometime. That's how Ashokavitva goes on. And then we have the Kavyavachana. They are masterly works of classical poets, many in number. From their works, some of the poems will be recited, and the Avadhani has to remember the epics, remember those plays or lyrics or whatever, and then connect who was the author, from which book it was recited, and what is the exact place. So the reference to context has to be given. And then while doing all these things, Avadhani will be constantly interrupted by one person called Aprastuta Prasangi. Prastuta means irrelevant. Aprastuta means irrelevant. Always constantly dragging into irrelevant questions, so that he'll be trying to disturb the concentration of the Avadhani. In one of my Avadhanams, Aprastuta Prasangi asked, what's the difference between piles and files? Piles complaint and files complaint. By cooperating in the office, files complaint can be solved. By operating, files complaint can as well be solved. That's how the answer was given. Sometimes very serious questions will also be given. Accordingly, it has to be answered. What's the difference between garage and marriage? One is for pairing and other for repairing, like that. Again, so such wordplay will also be there. Sometimes very serious scholarly questions will also creep in. This is how the audience will be engaged. Even a lay can also be entertained. And while doing, bells will be ringing. How many times the count has gone? How many times the bell has gone? A rung, that count has to be mentioned. It has to be kept intact. Or sometimes from the back, flowers will be thrown. How many times the flowers were thrown? But big flowers have to be thrown. Something like marigold, something. And then magic squares. How to solve them? Solving the magic squares, 5x5 or 3x3, something like that. This has to be done. So these are some of the elements which are present in Ashtavadhanam. And even more difficult things are also there. Something like Buddhistakshari, Vivargakshari, Vyastakshari, jumbling the alphabets and then rearranging. So many such things are there. And in Shatavadhanam, the number will increase. Here, 8 questions. Similar questions will be multiplied by 12 times or 10 times, and so 100. And in Sahasravadhanam, multiplied by 100 times, like that it goes on. But everywhere, Avadhani will be playing the dual role, that is of Purana and Dharana, focusing at the time immediately and then going back to his calmness, reassuming his composure and then answering back. It will be going on for 4 rounds. Each round, 1 line will be completed in these poems. Ultimately, 4 lines will constitute a poem. That's how at the end of the fourth line, all the verses are completed. And in the fifth round, all these verses have to be recalled from memory. In a Shatavadhana, all the 100 verses have to be recalled. In Ashtavadhana, all the 8 verses have to be recalled. So all the verses recalled from memory by Avadhani, and their meaning has to be explained. And if there is any question on grammar, question on syntax, question on something like prosody, question on imagery, all these questions have to answer, and the Avadhani's verses have to be justified. So it's a scholarly dimension having a lot of retention. The very great purpose of life will be revealed through Avadhanam, that is acceptance, enjoyment, and entertainment. As we all know, the world is a cosmic play. And within that cosmic play, a small play is what Avadhani is going to present. And this is a play with words. This is a trick with verses. And this is a sport with literary things. And in that way, Avadhanam has been the most coveted traditional Indian classical form of literary entertainment, where nothing is prefixed, everything is spontaneous. Here, no problem of match fixing, no such difficulty, no such allegation can be leveled against Avadhanam. It's all spontaneous. With this, I conclude. Thank you.